Today we'll be looking at more Smart on FHIR, and we will be taking a look at the standalone launch. So last time we took a look at backend applications. So this time we'll be taking a look at frontend applications. So by frontend, I don't just mean single page applications. This also includes full stack applications that have any sort of user interface. So this might be something that you have seen throughout your entire life, something like sign in with Google or sign in with Facebook. And that is actually what Smart on FHIR is for a front-end application in some scenarios, especially the standalone launch. So now the standalone launch, what it says is that you have your app, you open your app, and then from this app, you somehow connect to the EHR. Now the way we do that is primarily by clicking on a button or automatically being redirected. And the data that you get from the EHR starts again with the discovery endpoint. So this will be the well-known slash smart configuration endpoint. So once we hit that endpoint, we get our usual response. So we have our authorization endpoint, we have our token endpoint, and the authorization endpoint is what we are going to be using first. So now authorization endpoint is nothing but the screen that you go to actually authorize the user. So it looks something like this. It'll have a username password prompt and you'll go to this URL like ehr.com/authorize. So now this, again, you are in the domain of the EHR right now. So you enter your credentials here and it always asks you something like, do you want to allow this particular client to access these on your behalf? And this is again where you give in the scopes. So in the previous step where you are going to the authorize, you also include a lot of other query parameters in the URL like scope, client ID. There is quite a lot, but it's just OAuth. It's just OAuth 2. And if you use the exact same parameters, you will get to this page, right? So after that, you just, you know, check these boxes, say yes or no. This is again a prompt to the user, the final end user. It doesn't matter if it's a provider or, you know, the patient. It works either way. And then you come back to your app. You come back to your app, and this is where the app then needs to also provide a redirect URL, and you will get this code. Now, depending on the type of launch that you use, two things can happen. One thing is that you can directly use this code, and that is kind of insecure, and that's called the implicit flow. But this is what usually happens, which is you post this code to the token endpoint and then you get your access token. Now that will be your bearer token. Now, how do you post this? Is again, there are a lot of variations in this. There is PKCE, which is pronounced Pixie, called proof of key code exchange. There is also the whole backend flow where you send in a client secret. So all these flows are just to prove to the backend server that this code is actually coming from a legit place. So the basic concept is that you send the code and you get back a bearer token. Okay. Now there is again, there is also the insecure flow. Now here again, you directly get the token in the beginning itself, and you can directly use this to make your API calls. So this is a little insecure because things like, you know, Chrome extensions also get access to the URL. So again, security is a whole other thing. So we will not, you know, comment on this being more insecure, but again, this is definitely more insecure than the token exchange using PKCE. So wherever possible, use Pixie. If not, use the implicit flow. And there is also another way to launch your application, and this is the EHR launch. And this is actually where Smart comes up with a lot of new concepts and a new additions to the OAuth 2 spec. And that is basically the launch parameter. So if you look at an EHR and you want to launch your app from within the EHR. So again, this is a patient screen. And suppose I want to click on, you know, I want to open this in your app. I want to open this in this awesome app. So what you do is you click on this and it will then launch you to your app. So this is again app.com, and you will provide the EHR. You will register with the EHR saying that, hey, this is my launch URL. So in this case, it's launch.html. And once you get this, you will get two parameters along with the URL. So one will be launch. So this is an opaque token, and another one will be ISS, short form for issuer. So this will be the EHR's URL. So first thing that you do, again, just like always, you get the well-known configuration from the EHR. So once you get that, you also have this launch parameter. So now what you do is you do the exact same thing as before. You go to the authorized URL, but you also include the launch parameter. Okay, so this launch parameter in this case is just something like QWERTY, but depending on which implementation, it might be something different. Some people like Azure Smart on Fire, they base 64 encode the actual value inside, but it shouldn't matter for you. You shouldn't think about what this launch actually contains. For you, when you're developing an app, it should be an opaque token and you should treat it like an opaque token. So you just pass it along to the authorized parameter. It'll again do the same kind of a flow like sign in, but this time, apart again, other than the consent, you also have the ability to ask for extra parameters. Like for example, suppose in the EHR, right now the EHR knows that this is the particular patient and it can launch with the particular patient. But if it doesn't launch with the patient, you also have the ability to put it in the scope. So in the scope, if you put something like launch/patient, you will get this screen in the EHR asking you to select which patient. You can do the same thing for encounter. You can do the same thing for practitioner. So we'll again go through the actual spec and look at what these things are. But for now, you can select a patient. That option is always there. And afterwards, you come back, right? After you select it, you come back to your app, and this will be the redirect URL, and you get your code, you exchange it for the token. And in this case, along with the token, along with the bearer token, you also get these other attributes like patient, encounter, need patient banner, the practitioner. You will get all of these details also in the token response. So this is actually the main difference between a normal a normal OAuth 2 flow and Smart on Fire. Just this one extra thing, which is how tokens work and how you can use the launch when you are actually coming from another app. So this, you might think, why do we need something like need patient banner? Because most EHRs also launch your app in an iframe. So they can just, they have something on the side saying which apps these are, and they have already displayed the patient banner on top. So they have already put the patient's profile and the name. So you don't really need to again show it in your app, taking up screen real estate, right? So they provide a parameter like need patient banner, and if it's set to false, your app is expected to not show the patient banner. And based on this response, you also know which data to query, which data to show. And that is how you actually launch your Smart on Fire app from within the EHR. So let's actually go to Smart Launch Framework. So we'll go to the actual docs and we'll see this again in more detail. So scopes for limiting access is also another important concept here. So they also describe the scopes that are necessary to grant permission to a particular resource. So in this case, you have something like patient/observation.rs. So that means you can read all of the patient's observations and search on it. So RS stands for read and S stands for search. So this star, you can use any resource there. Star is also a valid scope as well. So now let's again go and see, this is how you really construct a scope. I urge you to actually go to the documentation page and read this for more information. You can also have wildcard scopes, but this is what I was talking about. So you do have things like launch/patient and launch/encounter. So these are just like scopes, but it enables the EHR to actually display the patient picker screen or the encounter picker screen when you are launching through the Smart on Fire launch. Now again, there are other things that you can use, like diagnostic report, for example, but not all EHRs support them. Patient and encounter is very well supported. Now again, this is again the things that appear in the token response. You have things like patient, encounter, fire context, need patient banner, and even things like intent. So again, this is not a very well standardized thing right now, but you can, the same app might be used for different intents, right? Like reconciling medication or prescribing a new medication. So you can describe that as a string here. There is also smart style URL. So if you want the app to be in the same style as the EHR, especially this is useful when we are rendering it within an iframe, it makes sense to send them information about how to style things. So they'll send you a JSON and you look at the styling guide and they tell you things like color, background, font, all these things as well. You don't really need to, you know, implement this. As long as it's functional, it's fine. But yeah, that is a thing if you really want to integrate well with the EHR. And even things like tenant. So apart from this, you can also add your own parameters. So yeah, that's about it. And you know, this is actually the full launch framework of Smart on Fire. This is what is very different from normal OAuth 2. Even when we are looking at backend authorization and authentication, it's not much different from normal OAuth 2. But this whole launch and patient picking and choosing the patient, this is actually a really good framework, I would say, for really general app launching within an EHR. It doesn't need to be FHIR. And right now, Smart on FHIR has been implemented over FHIR, but I do see it going on top of any API. So any API which requires the context in which the EHR has launched, Smart will still work. So that's, again, I think they have missed a few places where they could have made things easy for implementers. Like for example, the token response, instead of giving it in the token response, they could have put it inside the ID token. And that way they would have been OpenID compliant. But anyway, they put it in the token response and not a lot of frameworks support that kind of flow. But still, putting it in the ID token would be a better idea. If in case any of you creators of Smart on FHIR are listening to this, please put it in the ID token instead of the token response. That would make life much simpler for everyone. So yeah, that's about it. I hope you learned something from this video. And if you have any questions, put them in the comments down below. We are also starting a newsletter, and we have been doing that for a while. If you want more detailed articles and blog posts on all of these topics, please do subscribe. Just go to medblocks.org and subscribe there. And yeah, I'll see you in the next one.